to Jill and our panelists. We're actually going to spice things up a little bit now. We're going to take the next hour to have four different lightning sessions. So we'll feature four different industry experts talking about a topic that they've chosen for about 15 minutes each. So I'd like to first invite Stephen to the stage.
David, I do remember very well. It was great. Serious leader, if you do that, or just.
All right, everyone. We're now going to have Stephen Reingold from Saul, Ewing start with our first session.
Guys, we're trying to, we have a tight schedule. Okay. Everybody, let me explain. We have three, everybody, hello. So just listen for a second, please. We have three presentations, four, that are next, that are, we're having speakers speak on very important topics. They're really important topics. And so we really, trust me, it's well worth you listening to each speaker because they're going to talk. It's not a panel. They're giving a whole a lecture on issues that everybody needs to be aware of. Guys, can we keep it down there and get the people? Reed, can you see what we can do to get some help here? Okay, so keep the chance because otherwise, it's unfortunately you finish a panel and everybody decides to socialize. This is, I can tell you, the speakers are really, really relevant. And trust me.
Thank you, Ronnie. Good afternoon, everybody. So I am Stephen Reingold. I am a partner with Saul Ewing. Thank you for having me here today. So I'm coming at this a little differently, and I'm coming at this in terms of a complex commercial litigator. I am not an EB-5 transactional lawyer. I get called into these situations when there's a dispute to be resolved. And what I want to talk about is, you know, notwithstanding the optimism that we all have regarding the RIA, you know, we still have current businesses, current deals, and litigation often arises. So, you know, I'm sort of a professional cynic to talk today, and I want to talk about, just from a defensive perspective, some of the things that we're seeing on the litigation side, because while we're all happy about what's coming, we're all very optimistic, you know, following on the theme of the last panel, we don't have a crystal ball. So it's a little hard for me to talk about, you know, litigation under the RIA because, you know, that we don't know yet. And I do agree with everything that Ron said about, you know, retroactivity and whether that should apply or not. But, you know, we have to bear in mind that we do have a lot of current projects, a lot of issues that arise. And so I just want to go through maybe three areas that we're handling, that we're seeing on a regular basis, and kind of set the stage for you, you know, some of the traps for the unwary, you know, things to look out for as you go forward. And this is from the perspective of the NCEs, from the sponsors, from the RCs, rather than from the investors. You know, footnote there, we could spend a whole hour talking about, you know, litigation brought on behalf of investors. The mandamus cases, the courts are doing with that. It's all over the map in the federal courts. That's a conversation for another day. You want to talk about that afterward, I'm happy to do that. But, you know, I also not going to talk about the Baring case because everybody's familiar with it. You know, everybody's teased, I think, you know, with the outcome. So I want to talk about, you know, issues that we as interested parties in this environment may need to respond to. And again, sort of lessons learned, traps to be unwary from matters that I'm handling now or have recently handled, that our firm has. One of the first things that we're dealing with a lot is investors' requests for access to books and records of the NCE. And again, I'm talking about current investors, I'm not talking about prospective investors and the robust disclosure rights under the RIA. I'm not talking about, you know, expanded reporting requirements. I'm talking about, you have, you know, 100 investors, and eight of them come forward and say, you know, under the governance documents, under the statute, we want access to books and records. So let's talk a little bit about that, because sometimes they get a little greedy, you know, and I can say that as a, again, professional civic. You know, they want everything and they want it now. And so if you get a books and records request made on behalf of investors, obviously the first thing to do is run it by counsel. But you have to look at the four corners of that request, because oftentimes what they're looking for are things that go well beyond their statutory and documentary rights as investors in the NCE. So, you know, under your governance documents, and if it's a limited liability company, your operating agreement, under your partnership agreement, if it's a limited partnership, you know, they have certain rights. Investors have certain rights, just as they would outside of EB-5, to books and records, to financial and other information. And then state law supplements that. You have to look at the law of the state under which the organization was created. Is it a Delaware limited partnership? Is it a Florida LLC? The rights of investors vary, and they sometimes vary greatly. You know, if the investor's statutory rights pertain only to the entity in which they understand one thing, that if you get into litigation with an investor, that goes out the window, and you're going to get discovery from somebody like me looking for project-related documents, and things go well beyond the four corners of the books and records. So be aware that, you know, that is an issue out there. And sometimes we deal with that in advance, because the governance documents will say, notwithstanding what the statute says, you know, there's access to project information or information that we've provided to USCIS that will be provided upon reasonable request to the investors. But let's focus for a moment on the right to books and records. As I said, it's governed by state law and by the governance documents. And state law will dictate what investors are entitled to receive, when they're entitled to receive it, and who gets to make that request on their behalf. You know, sometimes a response has to be served as few as 5 days after you receive the request. So even if you get one and you don't think it comports with the statute or the governing documents, don't take that chance. You know, 5 days is really short. And why is it so important? Because after day five, the investor can run to court. And then you're in a whole different arena, which you don't want to be in, especially Delaware Chancery. Most states provide a little bit more food, 10 days. The other trap to look out for is when we hear books and records, certainly as, you know, everybody except David Appel, we hear, you know, books and records, we're thinking, you know, financial information. It goes well beyond that. And you have to be aware of that, because oftentimes, depending on the state of formation, depending on the corporate governance documents, you know, and this is a surprise to some clients, that books and records, in air quotes, can encompass as much as communications, including email communications and other documents pertaining to the EB-5 company and its activities. So it's not enough to just turn over 3 years of tax returns and a balance sheet and say, I've complied with my statutory obligations. So you need to be aware of that as well. The LPA or the operating agreement are going to expand upon the investor's rights. So you have to read that together, side by side, or as they say in Rhode Island, side by each, with the statute. Okay. There's also an opportunity, and this is, you know, something you want to look for when you get a demand, is that the governance documents can actually limit what investors can receive, notwithstanding what the statute says. Sort of a get out of jail free card. If you've done the documents right up front, you can limit what your investors can get. You can also, and this is very important, this is something I'm actually litigating now, in your operating documents, you can limit the uses to which investors can put the information they receive. You can bake in very significant confidentiality restrictions on the investors and their professionals as to what they can and cannot do with the information they receive. And this is often a cause of consternation for investors' lawyers. They don't like this. And I've been on both sides of this issue in Delaware and in Florida and in Washington, and it does vary. But by and large, you know, the courts will uphold a reasonable confidentiality restriction. So if you get a demand, see if you can push back and say, sure, we'll give you what the statute requires. We'll give you what the partnership agreement requires. However, you remind them of their obligations. And in fact, you can even have a separate confidentiality agreement that will bring in, you know, more than just investors, bring their professionals, keep them under the umbrella as well. This is something that we have used to our advantage on behalf of clients to really handcuff investors when they do finally receive information that we trickle out to them. You didn't hear that. The last thing is cost shifting. The statutes will often permit, or governance documents will allow for cost shifting. So in this day and age, everything is electronic. If you do an electronic production, there's a cost associated with collection and review and production. You can push that on the investors. So it has to be reasonable, but you can do that. Other things to look out for, there are some states that do require written confirmation that the person making the request has the authority to do so. In Delaware, for example, the books and records demand has to be made under oath. It has to a verification that it's being done for a proper purpose. If it's done by someone on behalf of an investor, say an attorney, there has to be a power of attorney supplied as well under Delaware law. So you want to look for all those. So you can immediately reject, or I would argue, you can immediately reject a books and records demand that doesn't satisfy those requirements. The biggest issue you're going to see litigation over, however, is those states that require what's called a proper purpose for the request. You know, typically in a lot of jurisdictions, there doesn't need to be any reason why an investor in an entity wants access to books and records. And I'll get to that in a minute, particularly under Florida law, which pertains to a lot of what you're all doing. There's a lot of litigation over what is and is not a proper purpose for a books and records demand. And you know, there has to be more than in most states. I think there's something wrong here. You have to lay out with some degree of particularity the reason why you're asking for these this information. So, you know, just broad brush, because apparently 15 minutes goes a lot faster than I realized. Just sort of an overview of what you do have to produce. You know, this shouldn't come as a surprise to you, yet I can tell you often it does to clients. You know, it's not just, again, tax returns and balance sheets. You have to give what's and use Delaware as a model, true and full information regarding the status of the business and the financial condition of the company. That's really broad. You know, tax returns, list of other investors, names, addresses, contact information. That's a real hard one to deal with for some clients. Why do I have to give a list of the 200 other investors? Because the statute says, you know, what are they going to do with it? Back to the confidentiality of the legislation. You know, there's a catch-all in most statutes, which is other information regarding the affairs of the company, as is just and reasonable. You know, it's lawyers like me who wrote that because it keeps us in business. There's litigation over what is just and reasonable in a books demand. There are other states, including Florida, where there is certain baseline information you don't need a proper purpose for. You can just say, I'm an investor, I'm a limited partner, and this is my request, and you have to give it to me within 10 days. And again, in Florida, you have to give that list of investors. Under the Limited Partnership Statute, Limited Partnership Act in Florida, you have to give a list of all the other LPs and their contact information, tax returns, other corporate documents as well. I'm skipping through a little bit here just because of time. So, you know, balance sheets, other financial information. So, sum up on that first point, you know, be aware that the failure to comply with the books and records demand in a timely fashion can open up a can of worms you just don't want. So if you get one, don't think it's something you can just ignore, deal with it. The second area in which we're seeing a lot of activity is challenges to the actions of the NCE's general partner, if it's an LP, or the manager, if it's an LLC. We're dealing with allegations of breach of fiduciary duty, breach of contract, disclosure failures. You know, you're hearing a lot in the other panels about making sure your disclosures are robust as you go forward. You know, sometimes we're seeing those coupled with an attempt to remove the general partner or the manager. And we're even seeing these challenges after the investors have received their green card. So it really has nothing to do anymore with EB-5. It's just you have, you know, a disgruntled investor. And that's where, you know, the complex business litigation that I do comes in, because it doesn't really have to do with the EB-5 backdrop. And you have somebody, you know, who invested in a project, got their green card, project did very well for 4 years, and then COVID hit, the hospitality project. You know, the senior secured debt is foreclosed upon, the mezz is wiped out, the investors lose their money. Well, I mean, that happens, right? I mean, at risk is something we all talk about. I have a lawsuit in Texas where I have, you know, $2 million worth of investors coming forward saying, you know, the regional center and the manager did all these horrible things that led to the loss of their investment. Notwithstanding that, this hotel that was successful for 4 years until COVID. So just be aware that, you know, whether or not it's an EB-5 related issue, you could see a lot of investor unhappiness. And so you want to make sure that you're, you know, right out of the gate, you're protected. And others talked about this, you know, Jay and the other lawyers talked about this, robust disclosures. You know, make sure everything you can possibly think of and then some is in the solicitation package up front, so someone can't come 4 years later and say, well, I didn't realize my investment could be wiped out if there was a black swan event like COVID. Like, you know, in that one case, I filed a motion for summary judgment. I gave a 7-page bullet list, single space, of all the disclaimers that were in the offering documents that the investors acknowledged. But yet, you know, you have what I call a shakedown by the lawyer for the plaintiffs, and you have to deal with it. Just in the interest of time, I'm going to jump really quickly to the last topic, which I think we've all dealt with in this room, which is investors' demand for return of capital. You know, this is something, fortunately, that I haven't had to actually go to court with, because most of the time the investors' counsel will simply back them. You know, this again goes to your documents up front. I mean, the best way to put a litigator like me out of business is to do it right at the outset. So if your documents are very, very clean and clear as to the circumstances under which investors can receive a return of their capital, then you shouldn't have investors' lawyers, you know, knocking on the door with their hand out, you know, and saying, well, we want to be repaid now. Now is not what the documents say. You might have satisfied all the other requirements, but now is not going to happen. And I can tell you that, you know, almost all of the time we've dealt with that issue, we have successfully defended that law. So I think I have about a minute left. I'm not going to take questions just because we want to keep the lightning rounds going. But after this or during the cocktail hour, anybody has any questions about any of these things I've talked about, any other litigation arising from current projects or past projects. Again, I'm not going to provide about future litigation because the RIA is still so uncertain and I don't know what we're going to see in terms of litigation. You know, that's all we can do in 6 months from now and we can talk about it. But if anybody has any questions for me, just let me know. And thank you for your time.
Thank you so much, Stephen. We're now going to invite Scott Barnhart up to the stage.
Okay. All right, all you guys out in the hall over there, get your butts back in here. It's time to go to work. What did you come to go to a coffee shop? All right. So I want to also say I am not Bob Kraft, either one of them. Anyway, so we are here today to talk about the new investment rules, or I mean, the new job creation rules in the IRA. Well, I don't know anything about that topic, so I'm going to talk about something else. No, that's a lie. So the thing is that I said I was going to, at first, they had me signed up to talk about TEAs, which it's the same old rule that was in 2019. So I thought I'd just touch on it. And that is that it's that some of the attorneys like to call it the donut hole approach, or it's directly adjacent census tract. So what has that done to the industry? Well, it's pretty much screwed it up. And you know, we can't, and it's made our jobs somewhat more rewarding and less rewarding. So it used to be we could always find a TEA by stringing together hundreds of census tracts, otherwise known as gerrymandering. Oh, wait, I should put on my timer. And then, but now it's just, you know, a tiny little area, which is really ridiculous. I mean, if you look at LA, you can literally walk to a block. You can't count any other tracts except directly adjacent. But you could literally walk in 5 minutes to a track that was high unemployment. And think about LA, you know, the average commute time is 30 minutes or so. I mean, it just very sorely restricts the area in which a project can go. And it has nothing to do with where the workers are coming from. And that's really what, you know, job creation is all about, the workers and hiring the workers. But anyway. Okay, so I digress. I'm done with TEAs. So this is the new law. These are the clauses in the new law, and it's, you know, hieroglyphic. So I'll just go to where I summarize. And so, well, you know, it was written by Congress. Okay, so the first one, and there are basically three rules, all right? And the first one is that indirect jobs, and I'll just, you know, point it out on the top, cannot count. Well, one other thing I should say. This is like just to the industry. These new rules are like this. Just, I could have just come up with a big, and we would have been done, because this, it's as if they consulted us and said, come up with some rules that will have almost no limitations on job creation. Oh, and by the way, let's have some direct job creation in there for projects less than 24 months, because we never had that before. You know, so really, when I saw this, I said, you know, we could just do this and walk away. But anyway, so here's the deal. Indirect and induced jobs, or they refer to it as indirect jobs, cannot count for more than 90% of the jobs. It almost never had, we never hit that requirement, and I'll show you why. The second one is if the construction period of project lasts less than 24 months, indirect jobs cannot count for more than 75% of the job count. Okay, so that almost never gets hit either, and I'll show you that. Finally, if the construction period of a project lasts less than 24 months, the direct job count from the construction must be limited by multiplying the original direct job count by the fraction of the 24-month period that the construction period lasts. Well, I mean, yeah, an economist could have done that, right? But it's we screwed it up. The bottom line is, if you look at number three, I mean, at first, when this first came out, nobody really mentioned, oh, by the way, did you know that before this new law, you couldn't count any job, any direct jobs for a project lasting less than 24 months? So this was a big win for the industry. And just an example down on the bottom, if a construction multiplier is 20 jobs per $1 million spent, and that's the way they always are, whatever jobs, whatever the multiplier is, it's the number of jobs created per $1 million of expenditure or revenues if you're looking at something like a hotel or something like that. So now if we have a 20 multiplier, so that means 20 jobs created for each, and this is construction we're saying, 20 jobs created for each $1 million of construction expenditures, then what happens? If the direct multiplier is 10 and the indirect multiplier is 10, and they a lot of times they are almost 50-50 or thereabouts. So now let's say that the construction period lasts 12 months. What does it actually mean? It means that we have to take the ratio of the time period. So if it lasts 12 months, 12 divided by 24 is of course 0.5. And we multiply the direct multiplier of 10 times down on the bottom line there, 10 times 12 divided by 24. And that cuts the 10 in half to 5 jobs. 5 jobs plus the indirect jobs of 10, we end up with 15 jobs. So that's how it works. So let's move on, unless there's any questions. There's never any questions. So then now we want to, remember the first one, it's 90% cutoff, right? You can't have more than 90% indirect and induced jobs over the total. So what I did is, this is, we use a program called Implant. They have 544 multipliers. So I took the ratio of indirect and induced to total and then ranked them from lowest to highest, from left to right. And if you see that line at the top, the blue line, that's the 90%. So out of 544 industries, and these are the multipliers, you know, how many are there? Well, it's just right up in that very right-hand side corner. Does this affect us? No. Oh, and one other thing I should say. Like in our executive summary, we do this, you know, we have to talk about the new law, right? And so we form a ratio of what the indirect to and plus induced to total is and say, and of course, it's like, and typically it's been since this passed, about 50 to 60%. So it never hits the 90%, but we just show that to USCIS saying that we've read the law. And so what are the industries that are above 90%? And this, if you look over at the left-hand side, the scale is 90%. We're moving up. So what if you, you know, I've looked at these industries, so I'll sort of summarize it for you. They're pretty much all manufacturing and power generation and things like that. I mean, you'll find a token one in there, but it's petrochemicals, electric power generation, et cetera. So basically, what kind of industries are those? Industries that are capital intensive and labor light, you know. So, you know, electric power generation, what is that? It's somebody with a gigantic power company and a few guys are running it. So those are not, as you might guess, traditional EB-5 industries, right? I don't know that there's any power generation, but maybe there are. I've never done one. Well, I take that back. We've done some solar power generation. So whatever. Anyway, so now let's move on. And what I want to do is look at my watch. Oh, I've got 45 minutes left. No. I thought Ronnie would freak out, but he's not paying attention. All right. Sorry, Ronnie. I didn't mean to be static. All right. So now there was a 75% cutoff as well. And so here I took all the, if you'll notice what, if you can read it over there, these are all the everyday bread and butter EB-5 industries that we use in our reports all the time. So it's all kinds of construction, legal services, management of companies, hotels, restaurants, and of course, both of the restaurants are down at the bottom. Restaurants, of course, are very labor intensive, as you well know. So anyway, is there anything that's above 75%? Yeah, there are some up above, you know, if you can read, up above 75, like the wholesale trade, which we have for, you know, FF&E and things like that in our reports. Those are a little bit above 75, but by and large, none of the multipliers have indirect and induced over total greater than 75 in the EB-5 industry. Again, this is like a dream come true that we get to have all this. So now finally we get to the one, the rule where it says something like, well, it doesn't say something like, it says something exactly like that. What we're going to do is if the construction period is less than 24 months, you have to cut the direct job count by the ratio of the time period of the 24-month period. So here are all, I've got seven construction multipliers, and I start out on the very left, whatever that color is, they sort of auto-populated with the slides. It's like a pink tone, yeah. No, I mean, but the left one is dark red. That's the total multiplier, and now what am I doing? With every gradation downward, I'm lowering, I'm multiplying at times the ratio of, it starts off at 21 months over 24, and then it just keeps going down and down and down. And what you can see is, okay, so it goes down to 3 months. The furthest one to the right in each one of these is down to 3 months. Now, there's nothing in the real world that takes 3 months unless you're just going to buy a place and then put in a couple of kitchens or something like that. But there's very many that have 12-month construction period, and that's like the lighter blue color. We've gone down to 12 months. And so what that says is that, like, for example, the middle one is construction of new multifamily residential structures. So that's condos. And so what, and we do those all the time. So it starts off at a multiplier of 24, right in the middle at the top. And within 12 months, what's happened? You've cut that down to like 18. So there are real effects. But what it's, again, I'll repeat, you get to count some direct jobs. Before, we couldn't count any of it. Now, and I also didn't mention, because we're about to go into another slide, that you get extra credit for on your assignment. But but that is that there's an interaction between the 75% issue and this direct construction multiplier issue. So what you see here is that there are some real haircuts that take place, but there's an interaction. And the interaction is the following. So what happens is you've got a multiplier that's starting out on the far right is 20. And I gave the same example, 10 direct, 10 indirect. So the new law requirement says you've got to cut it by the amount of time period of this 24, the ratio of the 24 months. So what's happening then? The bottom, so we start out with 10 and 10, and the bottom part, which is blue on my screen, doesn't look like blue on yours. I can't even make it out on that. But anyway, it's not such great color. But we start out on the bottom part that is blue, and we're cutting the direct multiplier. And so what happens? We are keeping the indirect, which is the top part, the red part. All we're doing is cutting the bottom. And we keep doing that, and the multiplier starts declining until what happens? We hit that 75 percentile where now we've been cutting the direct multiplier by so much, or the direct jobs in reality, by so much that now the indirect, because it's still fixed at 10, starts to become greater than the allowable 75%. So now what do we have to do? From our point of view, when we're doing an economic study like this, and we're using real job, real numbers, not just a multiplier, what we do is you have to say, okay, well, now I've cut the direct multiplier, cut the direct jobs, and I get a new job number. And I was going to give an example, but it's not worth it. I get a new job number, and that new job number now exceeds the 75% indirect job limitation. So what do I have to do as the economist? I have to then cut some of the indirect jobs to get it back to meet the 75%. Is that clear? Because I've got a quiz coming up very soon for you, not for me. All right. So anyway, that's it. So there is some interaction, and it starts to get, I think since this law has passed, we've had two projects where we actually had to cut the indirect jobs, and both of those were lasting 10 to 12 months. Okay, so I've given a bonus of a minute and a half. No, 1 minute. Okay, that's it. Thank you. Oh, I went too far. You don't have my slide. Sorry, I had one more slide that I sent to them, and they regrettably took it out. That was me saying thank you with my firm name on it. Barnhart. Thanks a lot for that.
Sorry, Scott. But great job. Barnhart Economic Services, LLC, everyone. All right, next up we have Jose.
Anyway, I'm going to be striking us a few words.
Hey, welcome, Jose.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for being down here in the lovely city of Miami. I know some of you guys had to travel far, and you're a little worried about the hurricane. As a Miami resident, I will let you know that on my family's side, they had no idea that a hurricane was coming. So let's hope that it's just rain like it usually is. But anyways, thank you so much for being here today. I'm gonna briefly touch on the differences between fund administration and going the audit route. I'm gonna be a little bit unbiased here. I'm a sales guy, so I'm gonna push fund admin, but I'll be a little unbiased on the differences between each one. Understanding which route might be the best way to take if you're an EB-5 manager and are trying to understand the complexities now with the new RIA that came out this year. Just a little bit of background. I've been in the fund administration business for 15 years. I've worked across hedge funds, private equity funds, and now EB-5 funds. JTC as a whole, if some of you guys don't know who we are a publicly traded company based out of the UK. Two lines of businesses, private client services and fund services. Across fund services, you probably, if you've been in EB-5 for a while, you will know us from the old NES days. And you probably know Jill and Reed, who are my colleagues in the industry. But basically, just a little bit of background of what the fund administrator role is. For those of you who don't know, our job really is to provide back office support to the investment manager, right? We provide, you know, financial statements. We provide investor servicing, treasury services. We provide, you know, the audit and tracking of the movement of funds when it comes into escrow, when it moves from escrow to the NCE and then the JCE. As you guys know, with the RIA that came out this year, it requires an EB-5 manager to either have an administrator in place or to provide an audit on a yearly basis. In terms of the services that we provide our clients, when it comes to the requirements of the RIA, it's really three areas that we focus on. We focus on the fund administration, which is really the tracking of the flow of capital as the investor comes into your project through the escrow and it moves through the life cycle of your investment and then the capital is returned. So we'll provide an audit trail on that end. We also, like Jill mentioned in our last panel, we provide co-signatory services when it comes to the disbursement of the funds, right? We'll review the documents according to the new regulation and then according to your offering docs, we will review and make sure that as money is dispersed, right, we are signing off on it and we are putting our stamp of approval that every transaction is made according to the disclosures that you've shared with your investors. I think, you know, when people come to me as a sales guy and they tell me, well, what is the benefit for me as a fund manager to hire an administrator? I think what I like to tell them is most of you guys in this room, your job is probably to go out, raise capital, and then develop a project, right? You guys are sort of on the front office. Our job is to take that back office complexity when it comes to your accounting, when it comes to your reporting, when it comes to all those intricacies in the back office. Our job is to take that off your plate and provide you a service that can make you efficient. Focus on the things that you want to do while we focus on the areas where we're showing transparency and security, not only to your investors, but to the regulatory authorities, to USCIS, when it comes to providing the right documentation for your investors, when it comes to providing audit reports, audit trails of all your transactions to USCIS. Now, some people ask me, well, Jose, you know, what about the audit process, right? How does it work? And if you know from the Reform Act, basically what it states is that you can apply for a waiver where you don't need to use an administrator and you can have an audit being done to your fund. And what I like to tell people is an audit is a great tool to provide your investors, but it's not live like a fund administrator, right? We're providing data on a daily basis. We're live looking at the transactions on a daily basis, while an audit provides the financial statement support of transactions that usually have been made in the past. So that's a main differentiator, I think, when it comes to that support. You know, I think you heard some of the panelists earlier. A lot of people think, well, an audit is cheaper and it's easier. It's done once a year, right? Well, you need to have a system in place, right? You need to have a team in place that can provide that information and that can provide those records to the auditors to provide that information to the regulatory authorities. So I think to me, those are really the two big differentiators when it comes to, should I go the admin, should I go the audit route? To kind of put it into perspective, and I'm not saying that an audit is less important than using a fund administrator. I think they actually go hand in hand. If you look at traditional investment managers, if you look at a hedge fund, if you look at a private equity manager, when they go out to pitch to an investor, they don't tell them we're using this over that. Traditionally, they have their administrator that operates their back office support, and then they have an auditor that does the audit. And in our private equity world, in our private equity practice, we actually work hand in hand with the auditors. So we'll provide all the footnotes and head notes to the auditor e-world to make sure that the audit is done correctly so the manager is compliant and whatnot. So when it comes to the EB-5 world, I think right now a lot of people think that you can go one way or the other. I caution to say, as investors become more knowledgeable and more demanding of EB-5 managers, I think it'll get to the point where I won't have to tell somebody, do this, do that. We're going to go with this. We're going to go with that. It's going to go sort of hand in hand, right? If you look at history, business came out of basically 2008 when Bernie Madoff. If you guys don't know, Bernie Madoff actually provided all his investors with audited financial statements on a yearly basis. Yeah, he was still able to get away with the biggest Ponzi scheme. So that's kind of where the administrative role came about. So now we like to work hand in hand with the auditors. We like to make sure that everything is compliant. I think at the end of the day, as you guys are out there raising funds, going out to investors in China, Latin America, you know, I think having your providers, having these services in place really just gives you the stamp of approval, right? Where, you know, as investors become more demanding, it would really just help you and benefit you when it comes to raising capital. So that's sort of what I tell my investors and my clients when it comes to deciding on the audit versus fund administration. That's pretty much my spiel. I think everybody else has already talked a lot about the regulatory portion of it. If you guys have any questions, you know, I'm not gonna sit here and pitch anymore and try to sell you on one or the other, but if anybody has any question regarding what kind of services we can provide, comparing the audit, how we can work with the auditors as well, please come find me over a drink. And that's pretty much my little spiel for today. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose. Last but not least, we have Lee.
Okay, done. Thank you so much. All right, hello everyone. Thanks for staying. I know there's a hurricane. I hope that is not the reason why you stay here. My name is Lily. I'm the Director of Policy Research and Data Analytics at IIUSA. That is just a very fancy way to say I'm the data person at your trade association. First of all, I want to take the opportunity to thank JDC America and Saul Ewing for organizing this amazing event, especially thanks to Ronnie, Reid, Brina for inviting me here. And if you do not like this presentation, please bring them. But I hope you do like it because I'm going to talk about some important topic. I'm going to talk about how the RIA has changed, how EB-5 visa is allocated. It's an important question because it's an important topic because it has a huge impact on the EB-5 visa waiting time. We all know now concurrent filing is amazing, but ultimately an EB-5 investor, they still want green card. So visa waiting time are still important. And at every IIUSA conference that I have been to, I got asked by so many people these two critical questions. One is, what is the current waiting time for an EB-5 visa? The second question, which is almost equally important, is what's the Wi-Fi password? Well, the second question is way easier because typically it's just the name of the sponsor. Let me know if you want to know more about sponsorship. Look at IIUSA. but it's the first question, how to figure out how to answer these questions really give me a lot of gray here. Thanks, Aaron. And also keep my job a little bit safer. But to answer that question, we have to look at the numbers. Before we look at the numbers, we have to look at the law, or what I would say, the new Bible of EB-5. Look at the RIA. These are the provisions about reserve visa that is new to EB-5. Essentially, right now, 20% of the EB-5 annual limit reserved for investors who invest in rural area, 10% reserved for high unemployment area, or people love to say urban TEA, and 2% reserved for infrastructure projects. So that is a total of 32% of the visa reserved for investors invest in these three categories, which means 68% of the visa are unreserved and they are available to general EB-5 pool. And this is important because Department of State just determined the new reserve visas are only applicable to new investors who invest in after the RIA. That means existing investors, even though they invest in the rural area, or even though they invest in the urban TEA, they do not get a chance to take advantage of these reserve visas. So they can only still wait for the unreserved pool. This is very important. Another important provision on the RIA is the carryover provision. So right now, those unused reserve visa will be carried over to the next fiscal year and make available to the same category. This is very important because it prevents EB-5 visa numbers from being wasted. Let me give you an example. In fiscal year 2021, there are, I believe, 18,600 EB-5 visas available worldwide. That's 18,600. Guess how many visa numbers were used in fiscal year 2021? Can I guess? 2,800. So that means more than 16,000 EB-5 numbers that could have helped to reduce the backlog, but they got wasted because there was no carryover provision. Where did these visa numbers go? They fall over to the other EB categories. So for those of you who follow the EB-5, who follow the visa bulletin closely as I do, you will notice that in April 2021, the EB-1 category suddenly became available, become current across the board. Well, it's a loss of EB-5 and again of other EB categories. So I understand a few of you who do EB-1C and EB-1A for your clients. Well, you are welcome. Another important provision on the carryover is for any unused carryover reserve visa numbers, if they remain unused in the next fiscal year, they should be made available to the general EB-5 pool. This is also important to help to reduce the backlog of existing investors because they are not able to use the new reserve visa. However, given the fast processing time of 526 or 526E right now, it's unlikely that all the carryover reserve visas will be used in the next fiscal year. That means there will be more visa added to the general pool. I know it's very confusing, so I use some numbers. If you can look at the number here, for fiscal year 2022, the fiscal year that just passed, a total of more than 281,000 visas are available to all EB categories. So EB-5 gets 7.1% of that, which is almost 20,000 visas in the last fiscal year. So with the reserve visa provisions, 20% of that 20,000 visas are reserved for rural, 4,000. 10% are reserved for high unemployment area. So it's like 2,000, and 2% goes to the infrastructure projects. So there's 400. Still, there are 13,500, almost 13,600 visas are available to general EB-5, as long as Department of State can process those visa numbers. But we all know COVID hit and everything just like screw us. And the left of the program, we believe that none of the reserve visas, those numbers have been used in the last fiscal year. Without the carryover provisions, again, you're welcome, EB-1. But with the carryover provisions, these reserve numbers will be carried over to this fiscal year. So if you look at fiscal year 2023, we estimate the official numbers are not out yet, but we think 200,000 visas will be available for EB categories. I understand there are a lot of lawyers here, so we put our legal disclaimer on the slides. In all cap, we guess. So we guess, this not our legal advice. So 200,000 visas are available. 7.1 goes to EB-5, that's 14,200. So again, do the same math, 20% for rural area, that is 2,840 visas. Remember, with the carryover provisions, that 4,000 visas that were allocated in the last fiscal year but remain unused would be added to this year's visa pool. That means there will be more than 6,800 visas available for the rural categories. It's just like Christmas, come early. If you keep looking at that, this is the carryover, almost double the visa availabilities in fiscal year 2022. But here comes the big question. Those numbers will be reality. So let's come to do a reality check. So for those visa numbers, for example, 6,837 visas available for rural category. Remember, these are visa numbers. Each EB-5 investors, when they got approved, they have to come with their family members. So let's say if you are a principal investor, you have 100 kids. So there will be 101 visas that just occupied by one investor. On average, each EB-5 investor will use 3 visas. So that means that 6,837 visa available this year will only translate to about 3,300 visas. 3,300 investors this year. So this is the capacity of the program. So if you look at high unemployment area, there are approximately 3,200 visas available. Again, divided by 3, there will be about 1,140 investors. Same thing goes to infrastructure. This is important because this is how the EB-5 program goes in what I used to say, correct me if I'm wrong, Professor, but this is how many investors that we can have per year without creating the backlog. So for example, why not we all know the market is open and then a lot of investors invest in these rural areas, invest in these high unemployment areas. Right now the windows are open, there's no backlog. The visa bulletin have current across the board for the reserve categories. But how soon the ship will hit the fan? Sorry, I know it's a little late and I understand this is Miami. We also can speak freely. Yeah? So it depends on a few factors. One is, are there that many investors apply for the program? So for every one of you here, work harder. So we need to have at least that many investors file their petition first to realize the visa allocation this year. So again, right now the approval rate of 526 is approximately 80%. It's very low. So we need more investors than those numbers out there. So you need to work harder. Thank you. And so once those investors submit their applications to USCIS, how soon they will receive adjudications, so they will become documentary qualified for these visa numbers. It depends on USCIS processing. We all know if you invest in rural, there will be a priority processing to help you expedite or make it faster for your 526E adjudication or 526 adjudication. But as I learned from a great lawyer today, what priority processing means is faster than normal. Thank you, Ron. Ron is not here. So it's faster than normal, but how fast? Is that going to be adjudicated within 12 months? Because we understand visa allocations, they renew every year. If those demands do not translate into visa demand, those demand for EB-5 do not translate to the demand for EB-5 visa numbers, they will get lost. So we have to act faster for investors. So essentially, what I'm saying is, one, there are so many visa numbers available this year. It's Christmas, come true. Second of all, time is in essence. You have to act fast in order to take advantage of this. And again, it's always not just you, but also USCIS have to act fast to make sure these investors can receive those visa numbers that are available to them. Another point is, there's a window right now, it's wide open. The window that allows the backlog country investors, namely China and India, to receive their visa numbers without any backlog through rural area, high unemployment area, or infrastructure projects. So this window is wide open. Next year, the window is even bigger. However, it's closing up very fast because as soon as USCIS start adjudicating those new 526Es or like new 526Es, those carrying over numbers will be smaller and smaller. And eventually they will be gone because we understand you all work very hard to ensure that we have so many investors invest in those projects. So those numbers will be gone and there will not be any carryover numbers available to the next year. So every year you just look at the new availability and that's not that many. 10,000 EB-5 visas available a year, only 2,000 for rural, 2,000 for rural, 1,000 for high unemployment area and 200 for infrastructure projects. So I would say why now is a golden opportunity. The window's wide open and it's time to get to work. Thank you.